Hello and welcome. I'm Tara Kelly, Vice President of Policy and Programs at MAS. Thank you all for tuning in to tonight's program. Before we get started, I would like to draw your attention to the chat where the MAS team has placed some helpful tips. I would like to also to highlight that there is a Q&A button on the bottom of your screen, and there you can share any questions which we will get to later in the program. As an organization devoted to protecting the character of our city, there's no separating places from the people who shape them. Traditionally, women have been the keepers of place, from Anne Pamela Cunningham in the 1850s to Jane Jacobs in the 1950s. In a bit, we'll hear the stories of three women who left their mark on New York City and visit the places where we can remember their efforts. They each stood up for what they believed in, from civil rights to women's suffrage to environmentalism, and their legacies continue to be felt today in ongoing calls for racial justice, equality, and a more sustainable future. However, there are so many more stories that deserve to be told. You can contribute to this important effort and help keep history alive. To share more, it's my pleasure to welcome LaTanya Jones from Women's Activism NYC to kick off tonight's program. LaTanya is the Director of Community and External Affairs for the New York City Department of Records and Information Services, managing the agency's public-facing efforts, including the Women's Activism NYC project that writes everyday extraordinary women into hashtag HerStory. Over to you, LaTanya.
Thank you, Tara, and thank you to the Municipal Arts Society for inviting me here today to share a little bit about the Women's Activism.NYC project. The Department of Records and Information Services, DORIS for short, is responsible for preserving the history of city government and making it available to the public. Women's Activism.NYC is actually the first of two community outreach projects which we started several years ago with the attempt to make sure that the records of the city reflect the city in its all of its richness and diversity. Women's activism specifically aims to ensure that the stories of women from around the world are preserved and made available to the public through our archive. So a few years ago, we reached out to schools, we partnered with cultural institutions, all with the aim of making sure that stories, both well-known and unknown, are available for people to learn from and inspire future activists today. Specifically, we are reaching out to schools, reaching out to organizations to share a campaign which we call Grassroots. We want to make sure that not just the people that you know, the familiar faces, the politicians, the superstars are reflected in the archives, but those of everyday people that can be your teachers, that can be your mentor, your mother, it can be yourself. And so we call this campaign a grassroots campaign because we're really trying to reach everyday extraordinary women and make sure that their stories are preserved in history. We reach out to communities and we tell them, you know, our oldest records date back to the 1600s. And if you share a story about your mother, your grandmother, those stories can be preserved for another 500 years as well. And this has really been a powerful tool to make sure we put the community back in the archive. The stories that you're going to hear today are all featured in our digital archive, and we look forward to more stories. I will share the link in the chat so that people can learn how to share your own story or the story of someone dear to you. Thank you, Tara.
Thanks, LaTanya. I hope everyone here will share more about a woman who inspires them. And now for our first story, I invite author Jerry McMiranda to the stage to share about Elizabeth Jennings Graham, a teacher and civil rights leader who stood for her right to ride a public streetcar in 1854 by launching a lawsuit that led to the desegregation of the New York City transit system in 1855. Inspired by her legacy, Jerry wrote America's First Freedom Rider, Elizabeth Jennings, Chester A. Arthur, and the Early Fight for Civil Rights, available for purchase at the link in the chat now. Welcome, Jerry.
Hi, thanks for the great invitation. And let me go to my slides here. There we go. I think, you know, when I think about Elizabeth Jennings, I think of, you know, just what LaTanya was talking about. You know, she was a working woman, and really on the day that this happened to her, the altercation, she was just going to work, and that's all she wanted to do. And yet she ended up you know, really, really making history and changing our city from a very conservative area to what it, to really what it is today. Oops, here we go. So who was Elizabeth Jennings? She was a New York City school teacher, an early feminist, a civil rights advocate, and I'll say a badass rebel woman. Her contributions have largely been forgotten, along with the importance of this era in American history and New York City's role in it. Many things have conspired to keep her story a secret until now. Some things you might not know about her. Elizabeth's father was the first African-American to receive a U.S. patent. Young Chester Arthur was her trial attorney. Her mothers and sisters were members of a literary society that raised funds to free slaves. And her abolitionist brothers were friends with Frederick Douglass and William Nell. Elizabeth started the first kindergarten for Black children in the United States in 1895. And I believe she was the first woman in New York City allowed to teach while married. So why is she remembered? Well, on Sunday, July 16, 1854, Elizabeth and her friend Sarah Adams took a Chatham Street horse car bound for church. When she refused to leave because they were Black, the conductor assaulted her and threw her off. Undeterred, she re-entered the car and the conductor tossed her off again, aided by a city policeman. She sued and won a landmark case that opened transit services for all New Yorkers. And I would just add that she wasn't just going to church. She was the choir leader, which was primarily a male-dominated profession then, as well as the organist, also a male-dominated profession. And this photo you see here is a picture of a lithograph of what Chatham and Pearl Streets looked like, where the altercation started. So the question I asked myself when I started this book, and I wanted to answer if I really was going to do this book, was what drove a battered Elizabeth Jennings to get off the ground and charge back onto that horse car? And it took me 12 years and 256 pages to find out that the answer lie in her, as Frederick Douglass put it, good New York stock of strong family values. And those family values really start with the father. And in the early 1820s, he owned one of the largest tailoring houses in the city. And he began experimenting with chemicals to clean fabrics. And in 1821, he was granted a U.S. patent for the process of dry scouring clothes. In short, he developed an early version of dry cleaning and it revolutionized the clothing industry at the time. And if you look at the far right at that yellow piece of paper, that's what the letters of patent looked like in Jennings' day. And they were fairly large and he had his framed. On the other side of the page is the announcement in one of the New York newspapers that he had this patent. But what I found was really interesting though, is this might've been perhaps one of the earliest cases of patent infringement in the country, where there was another tailor, Abraham Cox, who was also claiming that he had this great method for cleaning clothes and never wanted to back down from a fight. Jennings moves his store right next to Cox on Nassau Street, and they're going at it. Cox is ripping down Jennings placards, which they called advertisements back then. And eventually Cox vandalizes Jennings' store. He throws acid all over his beautiful gold leaf glass signs. So Jennings has it. He drags him into court and said, this guy's stealing my patent. And they go before the Marine Court in Lower Manhattan on November 29th, 1821, before an all-white jury. And at a pivotal moment of the trial, Jennings stands up with his framed letters of patent. He says, look, this is my invention. John Quincy Adams signed my patent. This is mine and not his. The jury goes out, they come back, and they award Jennings $50, which is a lot of money in 1821. And I think that really set the tenor for the family. And I think it showed Elizabeth and also all her brothers and sisters that, look, we are citizens of this country and we have the same rights as everybody else. And we have the same right to legal representation when we feel we've been wronged. And when we've been wronged, we will go to court and we will battle it. And likewise, Elizabeth learned a lot about activism from her mother. Her mother was one of the founding members of what they called the New York Literary Society. Now these literary societies were big all across the country because in the 1820s and 30s, women were not allowed to partake in public life the way men were. If they wanted to do charitable work, they had to give the money to a male-run organization that knew how to spend the money. And besides that, a lot of women did not have the opportunity to even get an education, let alone go to school on a regular basis. So these literary societies, women taught each other to read and to write and how to express themselves. So a lot of the research I did showed how during these meetings they would read from essays that they've written. And the other side of the coin was they got involved in politics even though they didn't have much of a voice or have the vote. If you look in this, at the center panel, there's a petition there. And those petitions were very big in the 1830s. People signed them to stop slavery in the nation's capital. So what these groups did, these women went out door to door and got signatures to stop slavery. And by the middle 1830s, Congress has got millions of these things on their desks. And they said, we don't want any more. We give up. Don't send any more of these petitions. So without a real seat at the table, women were making their voices known. And this is really, I think, almost the beginnings of the women's movement and eventually the movement that culminates in the vote in 1920. And if you look at the far, up in the far right, the picture of that woman there, that's Maria Stewart. She is the first woman, she's African-American, first woman to give a public speech in the United States in 1832. And she reads from her book, Meditations. You can see the cover of it there. Now, if you read Meditations today, you might not think much. It's kind of staid, but back in the day, she was already advocating women should be able to vote. They should be able to work where they want. They should be able to go to school. They shouldn't have to be tied to children. They should be able to have children when they want and how they want. And she was really, I should say, banned in Boston. She comes to New York and she joins this literary society where Jennings and the other folks are. And she becomes a school teacher. And I don't think it's any coincidence that Elizabeth and a number of the other daughters of these women all became activists and teachers themselves. And I think the high point for their group was in 1837 when they held a what they called a mental feast to benefit the Colored American newspaper. And that was in 1837. And they invited men in to come in and say, look, this is what our group is doing. And this is how we're going about it. And of course, the men had to be in a cordoned off separate area of the room, because if men and women were intermingling, it would have been considered promiscuous and scandalous at the time. And some of that money also went, I believe, to a slave couple that was escaping through what would be known as the Underground Railroad eventually. And that was Frederick and Anna Douglas. And I don't think that's something he ever forgot. So I mentioned about the, Elizabeth's trial earlier. And rather than go into a lot of detail about that, if you guys have any questions about it later on, I'll answer them. But I would just end it. Elizabeth was an activist all her life, whether it was through her church, whether it was helping out journalists or other people who had cases similar to hers, and she would write letters and give them money. But I think really the lasting thing is late in life, where she was somewhat forgotten, she could have been a very bitter person, but she ends up giving back everything to the community. And when she thought, our children need to learn to love learning and give them the opportunity to learn to love learning that white children have, she started a kindergarten, and they wanted it for free, but they couldn't find any way to do it. So she had three stories in a house, and she said to the committee of folks that she put together, look, why don't I'll give you the first floor of my house. You can have the classrooms there, and there's a yard the kids can play in. They can plant things. They can learn about nature. And when I read about it, it wasn't just a school. It was really a community center she opened up. On Saturday, she had sewing classes. They had bookkeeping classes. They had a lending library. They called the Elizabeth Jennings Graham Lending Library that anybody in the neighborhood could borrow books from. And so, again, with the upheaval in Manhattan, where you always have, one generation knocking down what the one before them did, Elizabeth is, and a lot of this era is forgotten and paved over, really, until the 1990s, when they rediscovered the African burial ground. And that's when there's sort of a renaissance in learning. And in 2007, a group of third graders get Park Row renamed Elizabeth Jennings Place. In 2015, her father is put as a member of the Inventors Hall of Fame. And in 2022, they're going to put a statue of her nearby Grand Central Station, which isn't far from where she last lived and she had her kindergarten. And I'll leave it at that. And like I said, if you have further questions, I'll be glad to answer them.
Thank you, Jerry. We look forward to hearing more about Elizabeth Jennings shortly. But first, I'd like to welcome our next speaker, Melanie Chan. Melanie will share about Mabel Lee, who fought for women's suffrage and Chinese American rights and culture in the early 1900s. Melanie is the national president of the Chinese American Citizens Alliance, first founded in 1895, supporting the Chinese American community, advocating on issues and initiatives that are impactful to Chinese Americans and the preservation of cultural heritage. We're glad to have you, Melanie. Over to you.
Thank you, Tara. Let me share my slides. Let's see. All right. So I'll be speaking about Mabel Lee. So Mabel was actually born in China in 1896, and she passed in New York City in 1966. Both her mother and father were born in China, and they immigrated with Mabel in the early 1900s. Her father was educated as a missionary in China, and he came to minister at the Morning Star Mission in New York City, and where he became a community leader in the New York Chinatown. Mabel had a very interesting, I like to think was an interesting childhood. She became a Chinese advocate for women's suffrage.
I'm sorry, Melanie? Mm-hmm. I'm sorry to interrupt, but we don't see your screen.
Oh, you don't? Okay, let me try this again. Sorry about that. Okay. Can you see it now?
Yes, perfect.
Okay,
thank you.
So sorry. Okay. Let's see. Where were we? You know, she was active in the suffragist movement when she was 15, 16 years old, and then she eventually attended Barnard and became the first Chinese woman to earn a PhD in economics from Columbia. What you see here is a photo of her when she was a teenager. She was actually highlighted in the newspapers as the Chinese girl who wants the vote. And the other photo is her and her classmates from Barnard. So Mabel grew up in Chinatown, and she lived at 53 Bayard Street. And you can see in a photo on the right side, I believe that's the building where she grew up. And obviously, it's probably been changed somewhat. The Chinatown community, you know, back in the early 1900s was very different than what it is today. But the community is very similar in the sense that they are still very active in fighting for the rights, just as Mabel was for her community. An example is that community leaders recently won a lawsuit against the building of a new jail in the Chinatown community. And one of our members of the Chinese American Citizens Alliance, Corky Lee, who unfortunately passed away from COVID-19 recently, was known for documenting the Asian American movement over the past year, and especially capturing the spirit of the anti-hate marches and community volunteers who exhibit the strength and resilience against those who fought, you know, against attacks against Asian Americans. So this is what the Chinatown is, and this is where she grew up. She went to high school at Erasmus Hall Academy, and this is where, you know, it laid the foundation for her beginnings into the suffragist and feminist movements. We don't know, you know, what the core education was about, but it was at the school which really catered to a lot of the increasing immigrant population that she first received her education and became interested in the suffragist movement. Okay, so when Mabel was about 16 years old, she actually was one of the few that actually led the parade in Greenwich Village up Fifth Avenue. There were 20,000 marchers, and there were 52 women on horseback, and she was one of the 52, and she's believed to be the only non-white woman leading the procession. As you can see here, she is highlighted in the newspaper. So Mabel, actually, you see a picture here with her mother. And I just want to speak a little bit about her family. So both her mother and father were educated in China, which for a woman to be educated in those days in China was a pretty unusual occurrence. And I don't know if you can see it, but her mother actually had bound feet, which was traditional for that time, but Mabel did not. And her mother actually, both her mother and father supported Mabel's efforts to improve women's rights. So she was a big, both parents were big advocates and encouraged her efforts. What you see on the right-hand side here, these are some of the examples of the signs that were held up during the march. And I want to kind of bring you to, I think, the third sentence there. And I like to think that Mabel had a hand in creating the sign. It said, women vote in China, but are classed with criminals and paupers in New York. So early on, she compared what was happening in China to the suffragist movement in the United States. So she went to Barnard for college. She wanted to actually go to Columbia, but at that time, Columbia was not accepting women, and especially Chinese. So here she continued to participate in suffrage parades and wrote feminist essays, and became eventually one of the first Chinese American women to receive a doctorate in economics from Columbia. Her father passed away when she was about 28 in 1924. And so she decided that she would give up a probably would be lucrative opportunities in China, because she was offered many positions in China. And she decided to stay in the United States in New York City to run the mission and to continue to advocate for the rights of the women in the Chinese community. She believed that the independent Chinese church was really crucial for providing support and a feeling of freedom to its community members who were otherwise marginalized and oppressed in American society. By offering classes and services, the church became a social service center for the Chinese community. And here you see a picture of Mabel with some of the volunteer teachers. I do want to mention that the Reverend Bayer Lee, who is the current Reverend at the First Chinese Baptist Church, has also done a lot of research on Mabel, and that was one of his tasks when he first became Reverend at this particular church. So the U.S. Post Office in Chinatown Station, Representative Velasquez introduced a motion to rename the Chinatown Station as 6 Doyer Street in honor of Mabel Lee in November of 2017. The bill was passed in the U.S. House of Representatives on March 2018. And what you see here is actually a plaque for Mabel Lee commemorating that event. So it really showcases the importance of preserving monuments which are relevant to the history of women or Chinese Americans. Cultural monuments are really important way to tell the story of American history, and it's so important to preserve this history. And it's really a tangible evidence of our APA heritage. You know, one would like to think that if someone saw the sign, they would maybe think, you know, who is Mabel? And they would maybe go online, do a little Googling, and learn a little more about the history of New York and the community. This is the dedication ceremony at the First Baptist Church. So this is actually the first time the United States Postal Service has named a post office in honor of a Chinese American. Let alone one who'd advocated for women's suffrage while attending Barnard over 100 years ago. She actually felt, Mabel Lee felt her work was necessary for a successful democracy. She set her sights on voting rights for women, despite the fact that Chinese laborers were forbidden to immigrate legally due to the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882. So I just want to read to you, this is an essay that she wrote when she was a student. The essay was called The Meaning of Women's Suffrage. It was published in the Chinese Student Monthly, and I'll just read a couple excerpts. We believe in the idea of democracy. Women's suffrage or feminist movement, of which suffrage is the fourth part, is the application of democracy to women. The fundamental principle of democracy is equality of opportunity. It means an equal choice for each man to show what his merits are. The feminists want nothing more than equality of opportunity for women to prove their merits and what they are suited to do. So she was pretty fearless and selfless in her efforts as a suffragist for women's rights, even though she knew that at the time in 1912 that she would not be able to be naturalized as a citizen and therefore would not have the opportunity to vote. But she understood that equality of opportunity was essential, and someday I believe she hoped that equality and opportunity would extend to the whole Chinese American community. It is not known when the 19th Amendment was passed and when Chinese became eligible for naturalization, if she ever became a citizen or if she ever voted, which is a little unfortunate, but I think she, throughout her life, she supported, you know, this idea of democracy, and she was willing to stay in New York to continue to fight for it. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Melody. Looking forward to hearing more from you soon. And now for our last story, we'll hear from Angel Ellers. Angel is an environmental educator for NYC Parks and the Greenbelt Conservancy, which manages and protects 2,800 acres of forever wild beauty in Staten Island. She will share about one very important woman who we can thank for helping to conserve this precious resource, Gretta Moulton, who in 1965 rallied citizens and politicians to save High Rock Park from residential development. Welcome, Angel.
Oh, unmute. Hi, thank you so much, Tara. As you said, my name is Angel Ellers, an environmental educator with New York City Parks and out of the Greenbelt on Staten Island. And I'm just really honored to be here today to present to you the story of Mrs. Gretta Moulton. So I will share my screen. And if everyone sees my screen, I will continue. So Mrs. Moulton was an influential female activist whose focus was to preserve natural spaces on Staten Island so that the young and the old could benefit from the power of nature, which is an especially crucial mission within the confines of the city. Without Mrs. Moulton and the countless community members who she inspired into action, these important spaces would not exist as they are, but instead rampant development would have erased them completely. And unfortunately, these types of infringements are not a thing of the past. There are green spaces on Staten Island today, namely the Graniteville wetlands, that are being threatened by commercial development as we speak, with handfuls of passionate, mostly female-led activists who are really putting in the work to save these vital natural spaces. Before I go on to share the story of Mrs. Moulton, I think it's really important to acknowledge that the land that I'll be speaking of was part of the ancestral homeland of the Lenape people, who inhabited the island and other areas in the region. The Lenape were the original caretakers and stewards of the land, and we honor them. Centuries after the Lenape were removed from Staten Island, population growth and development ensued in the city. And as we know, Staten Island is one of the five boroughs of New York City, having the smallest population of any borough, but the most parkland, dubbing it endearingly the borough of parks. Gretta was helpful in getting our borough to gain such a well-earned name. And since she was one of the main driving forces behind the protection and preservation of High Rock Park, we see this shining gem that is on the necklace of Staten Island Greenbelt today. The Greenbelt is now comprised of 2,800 beautiful acres of green space and 35 miles of marked trails, The roots of that consolidation of parkland began in the early 1950s when the Girl Scouts of America procured what would become High Rock Park from the Boy Scouts of America. And the Girl Scouts made High Rock Park their campgrounds, and they were excited to hear that an energetic scouting consultant from Needham, Massachusetts was moving to Staten Island. Enter Mrs. Moulton, stage left, to the saga that became Saving High Rock Park as the long cast of characters started to present themselves on the scene. Mrs. Moulton was born in 1912. She was very active with the Girl Scouts of Eastern Massachusetts in the 40s and the 50s. And she served as the camping director and commissioner of Cedar Hill Camp, which meant that she was in charge of all of the troops. Mrs. Moulton was well known in the Northeast for her activity with the Girl Scouts, helping to lead and inspire young girls through scouting, and was very active in her community. This caricature drawing shows Mrs. Moulton in the Boston Herald in 1946, depicting her speaking at the Rotary Club meeting, notably the only woman in sight who caught the attention of the illustrator with her strong presence and convictions. It is said that Gretta's work was so demanding that she was actually relieved when in 1951, her husband's work would take them away from Massachusetts. Gretta's husband, Horace, was a Dartmouth graduate, a lawyer for New England Telephone and Telegraph in Boston, and then he became the VP and general counsel for AT&T in 1951, bringing his family to New York. So the Moultons, along with their two children, Sherman and Anne, moved into the Gillette Tyler House in the very affluent and exclusive neighborhood of Toad Hill on Staten Island, which is adjacent to the Greenbelt to the east. This white frame house on the eastern side of Toad Hill was built in 1846 in Enfield, Massachusetts, and eventually reconstructed on Staten Island in 1931, after the other buildings in the area were moved or raised to make space for a reservoir. The coincidental fact that this home was built in Massachusetts and relocated to Staten Island, just like the powerhouse woman that we're speaking of, is not lost on me. And the home was landmarked in 2007 by the Landmarks Preservation Commission, saying that it was significant for its architectural design, for its association with an important period of American history, and for its association with three significant persons, Mrs. Moulton being one of them. Now, why is the home that Mrs. Moulton lived in or the profession of her husband important to this narrative at all? I think it's imperative to understand the context of her situation, that we are talking about a wealthy white woman in the 1950s who had time and resources to dedicate herself to her deepest passions. And we're not talking about passions of simply hobnobbing, but a burning desire to make a positive impact on her community by using her wealth and her connections to fight for environmental and social justice. I can't help but think about the less advantaged women who may have had similar philosophies, who simply didn't have the means to make those dreams come true. Or the women on the other hand, who had all the time in the world, but lacked vision or strength or determination to accomplish such incredible feats. And from my perspective, Mrs. Moulton was one of the lucky few who had all of the pieces falling into the right place to make her mission possible. Not only was her mission accomplished, but Staten Island and New York City as a whole continue to benefit from the fruits of her labors. And as history would have it, Mrs. Moulton was almost immediately recruited as a consultant to the Girl Scouts at their new Toad Hill camp. The Boy Scouts had made a huge impact on the land, but the women's gentler touch would now be governing the area that had been trampled and mismanaged for quite some time. Gretta was integral to the immediate needs of the camp, as well as the more complex aspects of keeping the program in tune with the rhythms of nature and the land itself. Gretta's early efforts had already garnered her the attention of the Audubon Society, and in 1957, she was awarded the title of Patron of Conservation. However, by 1963, the 60-acre tract of land that the Girl Scouts had acquired from the Boy Scouts at only $600 per acre had now experienced a more than 300% increase and was now valued at $18,000 per acre. And that kind of profit would be difficult for anyone to disregard. As the president of the Girl Scouts Board of Directors was anticipating the building of the Verrazano Bridge to connect Staten Island to Brooklyn, the idea of expanding development on the island made them consider selling the land, relocating the girls to somewhere safer, and potentially buying land upstate to bus the girls in. But Gretta Moulton did not agree with this at all. For starters, the round trip cost to get upstate from the city was $2, as opposed to just 70 cents to get to High Rock Park. And Mrs. Moulton saw this as a barrier of access and equity, keeping the girls from being able to experience the outdoors. This was one of her many issues with the prospect of the land being sold, but she would have to start to spread the word that the scout camp was not the only issue, but the land was also a priceless natural resource. But the power of the dollar and the fear of impending development were so strong that in September of 1964, the Girl Scouts actually did sell the land to developers for $1,067,000. And trenches were already being dug and cement was being laid all the way down to what is now the parking lot of High Rock Park, as Mrs. Moulton was getting very busy mobilizing local citizens and powerful forces in government and social services, environmental groups, and political leaders, namely Borough President Albert Maniscalco. Moulton and Maniscalco's action plan began to take shape, and by appealing to the City Planning Committee, Maniscalco was able to get the land rezoned to prohibit garden homes from being constructed, therefore completely souring the developers on the deal. And it was admittedly just a temporary fix while the team worked to figure out a more permanent solution to save High Rock Park from development and ultimately to have it designated as New York City parkland. In what would be a curious turn of events, they actually turned to the power broker himself, Mr. Robert Moses, whose city planning and urban design have shaped New York City as we now know it, to help raise the funds to buy the land back from the developers. And history will tell that his intentions were more self-serving than altruistic, but Moses successfully campaigned to Governor Nelson Rockefeller to match city funds and buy the land back from the developers. And on July 7th of 1965, High Rock Park was designated as public parkland, with nature programming beginning immediately under the Staten Island Institute for Arts and Sciences in cooperation with the Department of Parks. And Governor Rockefeller even held his conference on conservation at High Rock Park in November of 1965. Mrs. Moulton was quoted as saying that, quote, "City children can come here to learn about the interdependence of the natural world, which of course includes people. There are right now in Manhattan two generations who have never seen a real countryside. High Rock Park in the public domain now gives them the opportunity," end quote. And there may have been much reason to celebrate, but the concerns for High Rock Park were far from over. However, whatever was to come, Gretta was there for just about every twist and turn, even as the maps from Robert Moses's projected Richmond Parkway completely bisected High Rock Park. Mrs. Moulton would stop at nothing to ensure the perpetual protection of the park for future generations. And as a part of the Staten Island Greenbelt Natural Areas League, Mrs. Moulton and the various arms in the fight began to write the segments of land that Moses had drawn his parkway over into proposals for a larger consolidated public parkland. It's really powerful to imagine that a man like Robert Moses, with seemingly nothing to stand in the way of his vision for New York City, would have one of his grandest plans derailed by the army of supporters of Mrs. Moulton's mission to preserve this land. And it even came to my attention through my research that this very organization, the Municipal Art Society of New York, was among some of the prestigious organizations that joined in when High Rock Park was being threatened by Moses's Richmond Parkway. And for that, we thank you. In 1966, Gretta Moulton was named the Staten Island Advance's Woman of Achievement for her commitment to open space and recreation, especially for children. And they said that she was the person who single-handedly brought the impending destruction of the island's greenery at the hand of developers to a halt. Gretta was active with various civic organizations, from the Friends of High Rock to the American Red Cross, the Staten Island branch of the League of Women Voters, and the Society for Seamen's Children. That was until her unfortunate death in the winter of 1971, and the community mourned her passing deeply, and a memorial service to Gretta Moulton was held at the Council Ring at High Rock Park, with her ashes scattered throughout the park, making her favorite place her final resting place. And in that very same year, High Rock Park was given environmental education landmark status by the U.S. Department of the Interior. Its programs in environmental education have served students, adults, and family groups from all boroughs since then, and continue to do so. The requests from throughout the city to participate in environmental education programs far exceeded their capacity at that time to accommodate them. And this prompted the High Rock Park Conservation Center to seek out the extra 14 acres of land adjacent to High Rock Park to be named Gretta Moulton Park. And handwritten letters are on record from countless members of the Nevada Avenue Civic Association showing their support for the acquisition of the land and naming of the park after Mrs. Moulton. This area would also coincidentally protect the stream that was imperative to the health of Loose Strife Swamp, which was one of Gretta's favorite parts of the park. And the president of the Nevada Avenue Civic Association, Delbert Smith, wrote, quote, High Rock Park is not only for now, but for future generations as well. Not to include the Gretta Moulton Park in the budget would be horrendous, as one cannot manufacture trees, brooks, and wildlife, end quote. And the land was successfully acquired, and a brand new 1 mile long trail within it was dedicated to Mrs. Moulton in 1977. And this trail still exists today with its green trail markers. And as a very fitting tribute to the groundbreaking and trailblazing work of Mrs. Moulton, her close friend and colleague in protecting High Rock Park, landscape architect Bradford Green, designed an award-winning gate in Mrs. Moulton's memory, which was unveiled in 1994. And its beautiful black steel gates were stabilized by tall stone pillars, which display a motif of indigenous animals and plants, from chipmunks to squirrels, spartina grass and bloodroot, turtles and native cattails. The Gretta Moulton Gates inscription tells her story to everyone as they disembark their cars and take their very first steps into the park. And the Gretta Moulton Gate welcomes about tens of thousands of visitors per year to High Rock Park, with this past pandemic year being no exception. We saw a huge increase in park visitors as all of the other luxuries of modern life were shut down and off limits, as if perfectly proving to us the deepest truths in Mrs. Moulton's words, that nature will always be there for us to continue to benefit from her beauties, especially in times of great sorrow, grief, and fear, but we also have to be there for her. Today, High Rock Park contains 5 ponds and various wetlands with 6 walking trails and a paved park road for ADA access to the forest. Various fragile and protected species of flora and fauna make their home here today. And as the urban development and overcrowding of Staten Island continues to make us all feel a little claustrophobic, we, along with the wildlife, find sanctuary here in this protected forever wild site. And according to the Staten Island Advance, Mrs. Moulton had once remarked a long-held truth that, quote, I think Staten Island's biggest contribution to the city can be natural beauty, end quote. We owe everything to Mrs. Moulton, and I take great joy in being able to share her story and highlight her strength for new generations to learn her name and to carry on her message. And as if by perfect natural design, the memories of the machismo that almost stole High Rock Park away from us has not been erased, but instead overgrown. So today in the Greenbelt, instead of an unsightly parkway, which would have meant certain doom for the ecosystems throughout, we have a pile of serpentine rock that was excavated and staged here in preparation for Robert Moses's proposed Richmond Parkway. A literal pile of rubble named Moses's Mountain is one of the highest peaks on Staten Island, from where you can see an aerial view of the Greenbelt. And now with plant and animal life calling it home, it has become a thriving ecosystem all of its own. Because as we know and we see time and time again, nature thrives, especially with the help of a strong and confident woman's touch. And Gretta Moulton's lessons will live on with every new sapling that grows in the park, every owl that finds a nesting place, every longtime visitor who hikes the trails, and every first-time explorer who ventures to take their very first step. And that is Gretta Moulton's HerStory in place. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Angel. I'd like to invite you and Jerry and Melanie back on stage to have a conversation and answer some questions from our audience. Just a reminder, you can enter in your questions using the Q&A feature at the bottom of your screen. And I guess while we're waiting for Jerry and Angel to join us back, I wanna say I literally last week was driving on Toad Hill Road right next to the Greenbelt and stopped at a stoplight, and a wild turkey crossed using the crosswalk to go from one part to the other. And so it is absolutely forever wild and a wonderful place. So I'll just start with a kind of a general question for you all, and maybe Jerry, since you're a published author, you could answer first, but how did you find your woman activist? How did you first become interested in learning more about Elizabeth Jennings?
Yeah, well, like a lot of writers, you know, you're working on one project and you come across the next. So I was just doing research on subways or trolley cars, and her name popped up, and I was like, well, I thought I knew a lot about history, you know, it turned out I didn't. So, and I remember telling my wife, like, I'll stop when, you know, when I hit a dead end on this, I'll stop and that'll be it. And I don't feel like I ever hit a dead end. I mean, the story just kept growing to this, you know, into really a family story. So, And not only that, I mean, they were just emblematic of of New York City and what was going on in the nation. It was really, you know, they were really like, you know, just a, I don't know, just a symbol of what was going on at the time. So, yeah.
And Angel and Melanie, I think you both have probably come across your activists through work, but had you heard of Mabel before or of Gretta, or were you just, you know, introduced on the job? And tell us about your research experience.
I actually attended a Chinese Women in History conference in Washington, D.C., where I learned about Mabel and spoke briefly about her. And I found her fascinating because, you know, back in the early 1900s, you really don't think about too many Chinese American women being active, whether it's politically or even getting to higher education. So it was a little surprising for me to find out there was, you know, Mabel, who at the very early age of 16 was so active in, you know, the right to vote for women. So it just, yeah, very interesting.
Before I started working for Parks, I had never heard of Gretta Moulton. And I think that it is a little bit of a testament to LaTanya's effort to kind of highlight the everyday women in their places that are constantly telling the stories. Because yes, there is this amazing gate that welcomes every visitor into High Rock Park that says, this is the Gretta Moulton Gate and this woman was amazing. And without her, this space wouldn't exist. It's stated very clearly, but it's really easy to walk past something like that. And it's really easy even to work in the parks and, or even visit parks, you know, and kind of forget about the fact that every single square foot has history that people who are alive can't remember. And that history really is laden in the land, especially. And so this opportunity to research more into Gretta Moulton's life and what led her to do what she did and the ability to inspire so many people was really amazing, because I got to see that there wasn't actually any consolidated information on her around anywhere. So I was able to reach out to the network of organizations that had anything to do with her, and everyone was really happy to hear that somebody was, you know, trying to put all this together and that it would be on record. And now our conservancy will have it, and the Municipal Arts Society and the Department of Records and everything. It's really just been an amazing time to see that an everyday woman, and by many counts, is really capable of just about anything as long as she sticks her mind to it.
So a question's come in the Q&A, and it relates to one that I have that was strongly reinforced in your presentation, Angel, and then also I think came through a little bit regarding Mabel and Elizabeth. And that's a question about education for these women, and also one about positions of privilege. You talked about Gretta having the means and resources to advocate. At the same time, she's an everyday woman. Can you talk all a little bit about the role that education, we heard a little bit about family, but how did these women get to the place where they were able to stand up for what they believed in? And specifically, Melanie, the question in the Q&A is about where Mabel's parents emigrated from, because it was so unusual, her educational background.
So Mabel's, both her mom and dad actually came from Canton, China, or Guangzhou, as it's known back then. And they were both educated by missionaries, which was pretty unusual. So Canton, being, you know, south of China, had a lot more contact with the Western world because of the shipping. And I think there were a lot of missionaries, especially Baptist missionaries, that were in the area. So it was pretty unusual to have both the mother and the father educated.
And Jerry, in the case of Elizabeth, we know that, you know, her father obviously, you know, had a patent, so he must have had a good amount of education to get into his business. But I think you responded to a question earlier by typing in the chat about how rare it was not only for Black women, but for white women as well to have a good education to allow them to get involved in activism.
Yeah, and I think that's borne out by the, you know, when I was talking about the literary societies, when I would read some of the notes and the things that were going on, that's exactly it. They were teaching, in a lot of cases, each other to read and write and how to express themselves. And, you know, in the book, I have a whole chapter called The Great School Wars, which really showed also, you know, the differences between, you know, the education you got if you were white or if you were Black. And it was always a constant pull in the neighborhoods where, you know, the African-American community wanted African-American teachers for their kids because that helped engage their children. And the white educators didn't really care about that. So this was going on in the 1840s. It's still going on today a lot. Elizabeth herself never got to go to college. She became a teacher through the old, I can't remember the name of the method, but where you would, instead of just having one teacher teach a class, they would have proctors. So she became a proctor, and they said, well, she could become a great teacher. And it wasn't until the 1850s where the school board said, look, we need to have our teachers certified in the various subjects. And Elizabeth and another woman, Helena Poe, both passed with flying colors at their certification. And they were supposed to graduate in 1857 at a really big concert hall where, you know, the 8,000 people were there and all that. And they were prevented because they were Black. They were told, no, you can't graduate with everybody else. You sit in the corner and then we'll give you your diploma. So those are kind of the issues that she ran into, but she was never able to go to a college. They just didn't have the colleges in the 1840s and 50s for women, and then obviously later in the 19th century.
Here's another question about Mabel, Melanie. In addition to the plaque at the post office, do you feel the building in which Mabel Lee lived should be protected or at least recognized with a plaque?
That's a very interesting question. You know, we know the address where she lived in Chinatown. I don't know if the building that's standing today is the same building or not, but that's a very intriguing thought. And that's something maybe we need to do a little research on and take a look at. So I think that's a great idea.
Well, I have a suggestion for you, I'll interject. Even if the building has changed, you can also apply for a cultural medallion, which is a private foundation posts cultural medallions on buildings throughout the city. It's the Historic Preservation Foundation. All right, another question from the chat. I think this is actually from LaTanya, for LaTanya. Are you still with us? Can you jump on screen? Loretta would like to know more about the program in general and how you plan to continue telling these stories.
Hi, Loretta, thank you for the question. So the plan originally was to celebrate the 100th anniversary of women beginning to gain the right to vote in New York State in 2017, and the 100th anniversary of women beginning to gain the right to vote nationally in 2020. As you know, 2020 was an interesting year, so a lot of our commentary events switched to online, which actually helped us reach more audiences from around the world who want to engage with the project. But when we originally started the project, we set a goal of 20,000 stories. We are about halfway there. So I think that that aim will continue, and we're pushing through, even though the centennial anniversary has passed, we're pushing through 2021, hoping to gather another 10,000 or so stories. Those stories will be made available to researchers online. It's accessible currently, and we hopefully will get past this process where our reference spaces are open to the public and we're able to plan more programming that help students and researchers engage with this community-led knowledge more closely, along with an oral history project, which the archives has currently going on. So thank you for the question.
Thanks, LaTanya. Thinking again about commemoration, you know, we talked about a plaque a moment ago or landmarks preservation, but Jerry, you were talking about how Elizabeth Jennings' place exists and how it was school kids who helped to get her recognized there. Do you know more about that process and how they were able to achieve that?
Yeah, it actually took a long time. In fact, a couple of classes, I think in the 90s, if I'm remembering correctly, tried to get the city to pay attention to it, and they didn't. And it was finally in 2004 where a class was able to, I think, get that plaque that you saw on my slide presentation put in for Park Row. They did. And it was all the same from that same PS. I can't remember the name of the class, but it's right there, right there in Manhattan nearby. And it was interesting because when they had the ceremony for Elizabeth's street sign to be unveiled, it had brown wrapper on it. And when they pulled the string, the string broke. And so the wrapper was still on it. And one of the kids in the classroom climbed up the pole with the teachers and everybody pushing him, and he was able to pull off the brown wrapper. And I interviewed him for the book. And he still remembers that as a big deal in his life. And he actually went on into teaching, he says, based on a lot of the stuff he learned then. So, I think place does matter. We have a lot of places in Manhattan that have been plowed over. And it's hard to keep in touch with history when you don't have anything to really look at. And that's the thing I run into in my book a lot, too. There's only one picture of Elizabeth, and that's what makes it hard for a lot of people to visualize and get to know her.
Well, and yet, it seems like we do have something very physical to remember Gretta by, and yet it seems her story has gone untold. And so you, Angel, had to really dig into those archives yourself and assemble it. Do you have plans to look into other important figures in the history of preserving the Greenbelt? Or can you tell us a little bit about what that was like, connecting with all of those groups and putting the pieces together? Did you find anything super interesting or surprising while you were researching?
I would say that something that was most interesting and surprising to me was when I was talking about the Gretta Moulton Park, that they were trying to acquire the 14 acres of land. That part of the park, I've always felt, is a really beautiful part of the park because not too many people go there. And I had no idea. And it seems that some of the people who have been in the organization for a longer period of time also didn't know that that was the proposed name and the reason that that part of the park was acquired. So I'm interested in doing more research on that. I have so much information. The people that I reached out to in the organizations, namely the Staten Island Museum, which was previously the Institute for Arts and Sciences, which was the organization that took over the park once it was designated parkland in 1965, had so many records that it took me a really long time to get through every single one of them. I reached out to family members of Bradford Green, who created the fence. And also what was most surprising to me was I kind of sent an email to the Girl Scouts of Eastern Massachusetts, not expecting anything back from them because it's such a huge organization. And they got back to me with some of the most incredible pre-Staten Island Gretta Moulton information that nobody on Staten Island has. So that was kind of I went out on a limb with that one, not expecting any results at all. And then was responded to by Lynn at the Cedar Hill Camp. And she just really blew me away with some of the things that we were able to find out about her earlier life. I also had sourced some information from the 1940s census, which told me a little bit about Gretta's education, which was basically that she did not go to college as far as that census said, which kind of meant to me that her husband would have had to have been really supportive, right? So there are lots of different factors involved in whether someone's able to accomplish their mission. And so say she were very well educated, but she didn't have the support of her family like so many people don't have. It would have fizzled and High Rock wouldn't exist at all. So it really was a story of all these different pieces just falling into place perfectly. And that was surprising for me. And I'm really happy to have kind of unveiled that. And I look forward to going a little more in depth into her story, just so that we have like a complete account. And then looking into some of the other people. I know that when I was doing this research, it was brought to my attention by Jessica Kratz, who I work with at the Greenbelt, that the woman who was in charge of Pouch Camp, which is just adjacent to High Rock Park, which also would have been plowed over by the Richmond Parkway, that she was a very powerful woman as well, who also deserves some credit and maybe some more research to let her story be known. So that's pretty much it.
And maybe a nomination to the Women's Activists NYC. So, you know, we are talking about these women's impact here, but as you mentioned, Angel, that Gretta came from Massachusetts, some of her archive is coming from that other Girl Scout camp. And Melanie, we know that Mabel's influence, of course, had an impact, you know, across the country. What do you think, just, you know, in coming towards closing for each of you, what do you think that today's women activists and junior activists could learn from each one of these women? And what's the like lasting impact that they have, whether just in New York City or across the country as a whole, as we continue to advocate for racial justice, civil rights, environmentalism? These are all issues that have not been solved, and we haven't quite figured it out yet. And so how do these three women really influence where we can go next?
Anybody or you?
Okay, oh, I can go first. You know, when I think about Mabel and her story and her history, especially in the early 1900s, what strikes me is that, you know, she had a lot of odds stacked against her. You know, she was a woman, she was Chinese, she was an immigrant. And when she first started advocating for the right to vote, she was not even probably of legal age. She was a teenager. So to me, the lessons is really, you know, you can't look at what's against you, but you look at what you want to strive for. Because her goal was really to have democracy for women, and she felt that could be gained by the right to vote. And it didn't matter that she was not a citizen, didn't know if she could be a citizen, and she never knew if she would be allowed to vote or not, but that didn't make a difference to her. She felt that the greater good was the ability for women to have the right to vote. So.
Do you want to make me pick?
Well, I would say with Elizabeth, just be determined and relentless. I mean, I think that's what she was through her whole life. I mean, you know, I mentioned it. You know, she gets kicked off the streetcar, the horse car. What does she do? She jumps right back on, and you know, she gets, and she isn't just thrown off. I mean, she's really brutalized to the point where, I mean, they had a rally for her the next night, and she couldn't even go to it. She was hurt so badly. But again, that didn't deter her. I mean, she was told, you know, men are choir leaders and play the organ. Well, she wanted to do both, and she did both. In the bylaws of the Board of Education in the 1850s, it said, once you're married, you can't work anymore. Well, she kept working. Matter of fact, they made her assistant principal. Later on, when they didn't let Black school children hear a famous conductor who came to New York City, she complained about it vigorously to the newspapers and at least got the word out there that this was happening. So I would say the determination and also just fighting all the every little day battles, because it's not all big Hollywood aha moments. It's a lot of, you know, in the trenches, fighting the little fights that lead up to the big fights.
I really like what you just said, Jerry. It's definitely it's not all about the big mission, right? The big mission is kind of the goal that everyone's working toward. But in the interim, as you're getting there, you're meeting people, you're networking, you're growing community, you're raising awareness, you're doing you're making positive change with every step that you're taking. And I am seeing really amazing grassroots activists taking action. They just had on Staten Island a march to save the Graniteville wetlands on Saturday. And they had hundreds of people there, and it was amazing, because sometimes the odds may seem totally insurmountable and one person can't accomplish them all alone. And Gretta Moulton didn't accomplish hers all alone. She had an army of people behind her because she knew that she was really passionate about something. She knew how to speak. She knew how to inspire, you know? And if she had a friend who was a journalist, maybe, you know, draw on every resource that you have. If you have a friend who knows the mayor, you know, everything you do is important, even if it's, you know, starting, you know, a new social media campaign or something like that. You know, we're in totally different times now. So to think about environmental and social activism in this day and age, it's a lot easier on one hand, but it's like more difficult on the other hand, because there are so many people kind of in the fight. But I'd say, you know, even if the larger goal is not accomplished, really understanding that so much was accomplished along the way, and at least so many people knowing of the mission now, and, you know, moving forward in that direction of really favoring what kind of world we want to see, it's all really positive. So definitely as a woman with a loud voice myself, I would encourage all female activists out there to keep talking, you know, even to the point of annoying and frustrating people, because if you believe in what you're talking about, then it should really be heard. And, you know, all different voices really make the narrative more rich and more beautiful.
Thank you, Angel. Thank you, all of you. I'm hearing a lot about persistence and perseverance, and I hope that these stories of these extraordinary but ordinary women will persist and persevere in memory. And so, you know, in thinking about the tools that we have in terms of what we do at MAS, and we're thinking about landmark designations, street signs, plaques, murals, monuments, these are all core elements of sharing these stories and celebrating the history of the city, and in particular, I guess, in this case, her story. So I'd like to thank LaTanya, Jerry, Melanie, and Angel for sharing with us, and to the memories of these women who've inspired tonight's program. As a reminder, share the stories of women who inspire you at womensactivism.nyc, which is again linked in the chat. For logistics on tonight's program, I'd like to thank my colleagues at MAS, and in particular, Iana Angelo and Jackie Mualim, for all of their work on putting this event together. Our thanks extend to our friends at the participating organizations, including Raul Flores at the Department of Records, Martiza Cuevas and Megan Wood at the Greenbelt Conservancy, and the national and local chapter of the Chinese American Citizens Alliance for their important work that they do. I hope you will consider supporting these organizations. And if you're not already a member of MAS, I hope you'll consider joining us. Your membership dollars and donations help us continue to provide programming like this and support our continued policy and advocacy work towards a more livable city. Stay tuned for upcoming MAS programs and tours by visiting mas.org/events. And important note, our Jane's Walk Festival is fast approaching. It's May 3rd to 9th, with something for everyone to enjoy, from virtual activities to self-guided strolls. Learn more about this volunteer festival of neighborhood storytelling by visiting mas.org/Jane's Walk NYC. So have a great evening and hope to see you next time. Thank you all for joining us.
Thanks.
Thank you so much.